us of the one commandment which Jesus in the Gospel of John conveys to those who would follow him, that they should love one another as he loved them. Jesus said, "You are my friends if you do what I command you." And while this has a little bit of an, transactional kind of feeling when it's expressed that way, Jesus is not really being the kind of person who says, "You are my friend if you like everything I post on Facebook." He's not really saying, "You are my friend as long as you are not friends with anybody that I don't like." He's not saying, as people often say, "You are my friend as long as I feel that I'm getting what I need from you." He's saying, "You are my friends if you love one another." And he's saying that because the way the world is set up, the way the creation is designed, the way human beings have been brought into the world, the only way we have to love God is in loving one another. The only way we have to love God is in the flesh and blood of which we are made. The only way we have to experience the friendship of Christ is in our friendship with each other, in our bodies, in our physical being. According to the scriptures, and I think St. Aelred exemplifies this in his life and in his teaching, we do not wear a body like a suit of clothing on our true self. Our body is ourself, our being, the flesh and blood, the red and wet stuff of which we are made, is that through which and in which we experience the love of God and share that with each other. And there isn't any other way. We talk about hearing the word of God, but that is a word we hear in our flesh. The words that come out of the reader's mouth, or the preacher's mouth, or the celebrant's mouth, pass through the air, one molecule vibrating against another, until they reach us and resonate within us. To read, to hear, are physical acts just as much as to kiss. Saying you are my friends, if he is saying to be my friends, you have to be friends with one another. St. Aelred demonstrated that friendship in a long life, which, as many have pointed out, is, though he would not have known or used the term, nor people in his generation, a gay life. The life of a man in whom it was natural to love men. And he did not run from that love. He chose to live in celibacy. He honored his vows as a celibate monk. It is the case that up until the end of his life, the passions of the flesh were real to him and strong in him. But it is always the case that he knew that his love was directed to those of his own gender. And he perceived in this the gift of a loving God. And he invites us to perceive in our ability to love whomever we love and however we love an equal gift from God. Because here is a message which I believe the saint would approve. Here is a message which I believe integrity stands for. Here is a message which I hope is the message of the Episcopal Church, that there is not gay love. There is not straight love. There is not lesbian love. There is not bisexual love. There is only love. And it is love that expresses itself in and through our being. being, who we are, where we have been, what we have learned, how we have grown, what we have suffered, what we have lost, what we have gained, how we have rejoiced, the passions of our hearts, our yearning for connection, our desire for the strong, warm embrace of a lover and a friend. That love is in us and it comes from God, and it is love in each of us and in all of us. And one of the things God is teaching us now in our time, in our generation, in this place, and among communities of faith who share this vision with us, one of the things God is teaching us is to honor and cherish that gift of love in the ways it comes to us. Too many, for too many generations, have been taught to hate, to fear, to despise, to be ashamed of the love that grows in their own hearts. Whether it's love for the same gender or another, still sometimes people are taught, or believe they are being taught, to reject that love in themselves. The gospel teaches us, rather, to embrace that love, because in that love is the love of God. It's there. It's there. God's love is what calls forth love in us. And we experience that love in all the different ways our embodied selves can reach out to others. Friendship, perhaps, being the highest way. I think in our culture today, we often minimize the idea of friendship and its value and its importance. How many times have you heard people say, oh, we're just friends? As though that were less. As though it were smaller. As though it were insignificant. And yet, I think if we look back over our lives, we understand that friendship really is the enduring and meaningful thing. And whether we are talking about parents and their children, whether we are talking about sisters and brothers, whether we are talking about lovers or spouses, the fact is they can, they must, they do become friends if they remain in relationship with each other at all. I remember Troy Aelred, the founder of Metropolitan Community Churches, telling how, as so often was the case in public gatherings, people, even people of goodwill, felt free to ask the most astonishing questions that you would never ask any person that you perceived to be straight. Asking him what he and his husband knew about. He says, we've been married for 20 years. He says, we sleep. Sometimes we get up and then we sleep some more. We become friends when we join our lives together. And the fires of passion may die down from what they once were, but the light of friendship can grow brighter as life and as time and as years and as experiences accumulate. St. Aelred taught us the value of that friendship. The words that we read earlier today speak to us of the value that he found in the friendships he shared with his fellow monks. He also said this, referencing the scene from which today's gospel is taken, the Last Supper, as described in the Gospel of John. He says, Jesus himself is in everything like us, patient and compassionate with others in every matter. He transfigured this sort of love through the expression of his own love, for he allowed only one, not all, to recline on his breast as a sign of his special love. And the closer they were, the more copiously did the secrets of their to see the love of Christ reflected in his own love for his friends. And he invites us to seek and see the love of God in our love for each other, our love for our spouse, our love for our family, our love for our friends, our love for the members of our community, our love for the people of the world, our love for ourselves, our value as children of God, who were created in the image and likeness of God, who are loved by a heavenly parent with a love that can never, ever pass away. I feel I would be remiss today not to mention to you, in case you haven't heard about this, the death of Jean Manford, who was the founder of PFLAG, Parents and Friends of Lesbians and Gays. She died peacefully in her sleep at the age of 92 in Daly City, California. Ms. Manford was a mother of three and a New York City elementary school teacher when her defiance in the face of violence thrust her onto the national stage and led her to found an organization known as PFLAG, which now has more than 200,000 members and more than 350 affiliates across the nation. In April 1972, one of her sons, the late Morty Manford, was beaten at a gay rights demonstration in New York by a former amateur boxing champion, and police failed to respond. Mrs. Manford penned a letter to the New York Post later that month that read, "I have a homosexual son, and I love him." Not long after, she marched with her son in New York's Christopher Street Liberation Day March, a precursor to the present-day Pride Parades, carrying a sign saying, "Parents of gays, unite in support of our children." It is impossible to overemphasize how meaningful this act was to the people who witnessed it, and how meaningful Jean's witness was to gay and lesbian people of the 70s, 80s, 90s, even to today, who sometimes felt the lack of that parental love, which she was so freely willing to give and invite people to share. Her daughter says she never thought twice about it. She fought for it. This was a 5'2" thin blonde woman who had a spine of steel. She just did what she knew to be right. There, I believe, is an expression of the friendship of Christ, the love for one another as Christ loves us. Love in action. Friendship. The friendship of a mother for her son, and for all gay and lesbian children. The friendship of a mother for other mothers and fathers who were struggling and not understanding, and found in her an invitation to come out and to be loving and healing presence in the world. We today feel that same invitation. We today experience that same love. We today are part of a process here in this church, here in this chapter of integrity, here in this communion,